All right, so welcome again.
Welcome.
Today, I think you're going to be a regular guest on these movie reviews.
He doesn't like watching movies alone.
Why would I? Right? That's why one of the many reasons I got married.
You're not alone. You're with them.
One of the many reasons I got married was to have somebody to watch movies with.
That's why?
One of the
it's
many.
It's all becoming clear now.
One of the many.
I'll watch movies with you. You're fun to watch movies
so,
with.
So you're fun to discuss movies with, too. What do you guys think? Is she fun to discuss movies with?
You guys don't care, do you?
All right. So today, like I said in the last one, we're going to do a newer movie. Now, when I say newer, I mean not from 1960s. This one, 1984, Streets of Fire, on today's Graybeard Biker. Alright, so as we get started here, once again, we're doing dinner in a movie.
We're doing leftovers in a movie.
I've got my leftover hibachi here. And so, yeah, that's good.
Mm-hmm. Set against a brooding rock and roll landscape. Ooh, you have my attention.
Okay, so we're going to watch Streets of Fire today, which has Michael Parr and Diane Lane and Willem Dafoe in it. So modern actors, people that are still acting. There's also Rick Moranis and Amy Madigan are
Rick
in it.
Rick Moranis is in this.
Yes, he is. He shrunk the kids.
Honey, I shrunk the kids.
What?
And the Thompson kids too. They're about this big. They're in the backyard.
I did. I am excited about the Rick Moranis sighting.
So see, new movie. Newer.
He thinks that 1984 movie was like 5 years ago.
People that still are acting are in this movie. So anyway.
People that are still alive.
The idea behind this movie, just to kind of set the ground, the director of this movie, who is Walter Hill, he was fresh off the cuff of 48 Hours with Eddie Murphy. Now, 48 Hours, when that movie came out, was a huge success. If you've seen it, you know why. And the studios were willing to give him anything and everything. And so they were like, you want to make a movie? Make a movie. What movie you want to make? Can we make a movie? And so he reached back into his childhood, and he had this idea for a movie when he was a kid. And so this idea for a movie included everything that he wanted as a child. Motorcycles, war vets, rock and roll singing, girls.
Rick Moranis.
He put everything from his childhood into this idea, and that's the movie he decided to make. So it's called Streets of Fire, and Vanna, would you like to read the synopsis here? The synopsis?
Okay. All right. This is PG, so feel free to watch this in the presence of your children. Not this video, but this video. Set against a brooding rock and roll landscape, Streets of Fire tells the story of a motorcycle gang that kidnaps a young diva. Her only hope for rescue lies with three unlikely heroes comprised of a soldier of fortune, a beer-guzzling lowlife, and the abducted singer's manager.
Dun, 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 dun.
Dun, dun, dun.
So, again, I haven't seen this.
It is suspenseful, romantic, easygoing, and emotional.
I haven't seen this. I do know that when I was given a list of biker films to consider, this was on the list. It is considered a cult classic. That's all I know. I didn't see it in the theater. I was very much alive during this time, and I didn't see it then. So, hey, let's see what...
It's got a pretty high star rating.
Let's see how it goes.
Oh my gosh, this is Chicago. Yeah, this is the Gold District. This is right underneath the L train. Red Line.
Show.
The both of them.
Hey, big crowd, huh?
Hey.
Yeah, now one of them's got a pot to piss in.
I told you they didn't like short people down there.
Richie! Yeah! Richie!
Come here every night.
Hey, it's the cook! Or is it the comedian? Hey, nice suit, Richie. Let's go, Gene.
See you later, Richie.
See you around, Izod.
If that doesn't jog your memory, he's also the one that says, blah, 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 nice ass. Same guy.
Alex, sit down here, will you? Cecil, this is a nice ass. Soft. Round. Snug. Hey, she looks.
Hey! Simba! Hold!
Fuck off!
Hand gestures.
Oh, no, that's what he's doing. And then she pours her drink in his lap. No idea what his name is. It's like a music video with all the steam and the wet streets.
Yeah.
I need you better. Let me guess, to our hero.
You know, with all the neon. It does look like a movie video. And There's been no real dialogue yet. It's all music.
I'll try it again.
I love the transition. So far, the girls are the ones that got any action.
Take that one, sweetie. You better pray you make it out of the battery.
I don't think she's there.
Ran into someone that likes to play as rough as I do.
Yeah, this must be your lucky night.
I'm lucky? I guess maybe I am. And you're dumb. Real dumb if you think you can pull this off.
I think you're forgetting something.
And I'll be waiting.
I got the gun.
I can get guns, smart guy. Lots of
we're on the move.
All right, so our first intermission, 48 minutes in. There's a couple things you could kind of notice about this. Lots of neon. Generally speaking, it has a very similar look to 48 Hours. It is a stylistic film that is called hyperrealism. And so when you look at it, you kind of have to know that it has this kind of futuristic comic book look to it on purpose. It's a stylistic choice. It's got more people in it that we didn't know that we knew, which is interesting. What are your thoughts so far?
I do think it's like, it's its own timeline. It's not real. So I guess that I would say there's a hyper-realism to that. There is a lot of neon. And it does have, as far as comic book vibe, the only thing I can think of that would give it that feeling for me is it does have some really fun transitions.
It does.
And it has some fun camera work. And it has some interesting lighting choices, if I want to get real nitpicky about it. The bad guys are all, well, except for Willem Dafoe. But most of the bad guys have like fence or like some sort of pattern lighting across their face. And the our hero characters are always like soft lit. And they look like really stunning. And all the bad guys have like some sort of gobo pattern across their face. Like it's very intentional. I think as far as the casting choices, I don't like Rick Moranis in this so far.
He's being a tough guy in this one. He's the toughest nerd you've ever seen.
I mean, yeah. But he's Rick Moranis. And like at some point you just want to be like, shut up. Shut up. Now I think Amy Madigan, who plays McCoy, she's great. Like she's been in other things, and this is right in her wheelhouse. I mean, this is her acting like she normally does, sort of tough, rough around the edges.
She was actually picked to play a different part. I think she was supposed to be the sister. And when she read the script, she came back to the director. She's like, I love McCoy. Well, McCoy was a guy. Was originally written as a guy.
Okay.
And she convinced him to rewrite it as a girl.
That's cool.
So the sidekick in this is female.
I do appreciate that little side story. That's neat. My only problem with the McCoy, Cody, and Rick Moranis dynamic that's happening in this part here.
Billy Fish.
I'm Billy Fish. Is that they're all...
No,
all
it's fish.
What do you call a fish with no eyes?
Fish.
What the only problem I have with the three of them is that they're all the same character right now. Yeah. They're all like cutting one-liners and like too cool for everything and shut up, man. Like there's no dynamic. There's no yin and yang. There's nobody playing. Like, you know, you talk about another 48 hours. There's a balance and there's no balance here. They're all the same character. They're all the same lines.
Well, Diane Lane is a good actress, and she hasn't had much to do at all yet. Now, to answer your earlier question, she did not sing in this. Now, she took the role because she thought she was going to be able to sing.
Oh, boo. But they took it away from her?
The director let other people sing. They said something about, you know, it was too difficult for one person to do. They combined two different voices, blah, blah, blah. It didn't sound too difficult to me.
No.
Of course, I haven't gone through
this. She looks great. She's beautiful.
She does. She's
got great hair.
She's 17 in this.
She's 17?
Yep.
Are you serious?
Yep. Unless I'm wrong. If I'm wrong, I'll put it right here.
Wow. Yep. I mean, she's pretty sexed up looking for 17. Wow. Okay. Okay. I mean, Diane Lane's a beautiful woman anyway. But I'm also not, like, super in love with Michael Parr yet. He's not a lot of great acting.
He's in Eddie and the Cruisers. He's not a great actor in it either.
But we're only halfway through. Maybe the second half will be amazing.
Maybe it will.
Redemption.
Let's find out.
Welcome back to the movie.
Hey!
Hey!
What's Better Off Dead Girl?
The quintessential 80s sidekick chick.
Better off dead!
Reggie.
Hey. Five Heartbeats is back there.
Aren't you Elaine?
That's right, it's Elaine.
Hey, Ellen, you guys need an opener or anything? I mean,
Robert Townsend.
Yeah, we are good. We just can't seem to get anything going.
Hey, look, what gives? I handle the management and the booking. Now, you guys just shut up and we'll out of the picture now.
You're gonna get smacked in the face with the butt end of a rifle.
Things that a guy like you could never do. Things that matter in the real world.
Alright!
Hey, whoa. We don't need to be back with the bike.
Come on, man, let's get out of here! Come on, let's go!
It's raining.
Come on out into the rain.
Don't talk to me that way. I ain't no punk ass beach!
He's like, thank you for doing my job, Tom, and going and rescuing the citizen that was abducted.
You're no punk ass bitch.
I'm no punk bitch.
I ain't no punk bitch neither.
I'm no punk bitch.
I'll come back there and knock that head off.
No Tom Wade to somebody
wait.
Else.
What was I supposed to do? I hadn't heard from you in 2 years. You didn't even write me a letter. What did I do that was so wrong?
It's the notebook.
Wow. That was like an awkward transition. Like, and grab her and kiss her.
Let's go.
Something, Waldo? We're gonna be rich.
Yeah. Long live rock and roll.
Sit down, Waldo.
Sit down, Waldo.
This is the
car. Take off. Yeah.
So, Streets of Fire, what did you think of the film?
Not good. Not my favorite.
It did have a motorcycle club in it, motorcycle gang, they actually called it.
Yeah, but it's not really a biker movie.
But it's not really a biker movie. I guess we got to figure out how we're going to define that. You know what I mean? It doesn't fit... It's got a motorcycle club in it. The motorcycle club is the adversary. I mean, it's got a big role in it.
Really, a but gang. It's not... just a gang. They just happen to travel on motorcycles.
Well, they had a street gang, too.
But you never get to see the bikes, really.
No, and it wasn't... I wouldn't say this is part of the biker genre. It's ranked 4.5 stars out of 5. So, I mean, it's ranked pretty good on Prime, which is where we're watching it. It was actually supposed to be a trilogy. This was the first out of three movies that they had planned. And then I guess this one didn't do as well, so they didn't make the other two.
But yes. So did you like this movie?
I didn't mind sitting down watching it. There was a lot of Jim Steinman in it. He is, and I know people that aren't musicians don't know who he is the guy that wrote all of Meatloaf's songs. So everything in it sounded like him. It sounded like Bonnie Tyler, Total Eclipse of the Heart. All those songs sounded like that. I wonder if he wrote that.
Every now and then I get a little bit terrified, and then I see the look in your eyes.
I did like the music, I will say that.
Let me see if he wrote that.
I like the music in this.
Jim Steinman. Ta-da! So, yeah. So, it sounded just like him. He has a certain style, which is why it's recognizable. But Diane Lane's part wasn't big. Nobody's part was big, really. There's not a lot of acting that's going on.
I mean, the two main characters were the most, you know, McCoy and Cody had the most, well, and Rick Moranis wouldn't shut up.
Yeah,
but they all had the same lines. Like, it could have been, anybody could have said those lines. There was no differentiating between the characters, really, except Rick Moranis was, like, annoying about it. But otherwise, they all had this sort of snarky, like, shut up, you know, shut up, man, like, attitude to the whole thing.
Yeah, so I think that the standout parts in this, to me, were Rick Moranis not being a pushover.
There's no redeemable character. Like, you don't like anybody.
He wasn't. He wasn't a cool guy, and he wasn't. He was still a nerd, but he was tough, which is odd for him. So that was a standout part. The other things that I liked was I liked when all the bikes came in. That was impressive, because a group of motorcycles is impressive. I don't care who you are. The fact that they all looked like they came out of the Village People was a little weird. They all had the same hat, the same coat, except for the guy from Flashdance.
They're all wearing duster jackets, too, which you don't ride.
No, all of them didn't, just the one.
Well, and you know, I'm just really glad they didn't get off the bikes in those suspender things.
Yeah. Yeah. And I know when they were driving up, there was two of them that looked like they had turrets, and it was like two people high. I didn't look close enough to see what that was. If maybe got
Mad Maxy looking.
Yeah, maybe they were standing up in a sidecar. I don't know, but that was a little, I don't know. I would say if you're going to skip a movie, you could skip this one. It was, I mean, it had some nice things to look at. It was obviously a style thing. Wasn't great, in my opinion.
Total waste of time.
All right, so let's talk about trivia. All right, so trilogy. The second film was supposed to be called The Far City, and the third was supposed to be called Cody's Return. We didn't really get a lot of backstory on Cody. He evidently felt second fiddle to the girl's music career, so he ran off and joined the army, and he came back, and that's what we got. That's
yeah, it. And apparently he was a hired gun where the police were like, please go do our jobs for us because we're just going to sit here and smoke cigars.
Yep. Okay, so another piece of trivia. The final fight scene, the one with the hammers, it was evidently originally a lot more violent and a lot more graphic than they showed. And in the end, it was toned down and made to look more like a music video on purpose. So the original ending, Michael Parr, Cody, was supposed to stab him, it says. Hmm. So that might have changed the tone of the movie a bit in a positive direction. Here's the other thing that I was going to tell you that I actually did know, but it's actually in this trivia list here too. Michael Parr didn't know how to drive a motorcycle. So that scene where he escapes from the first running with the bombers on the motorcycle, he had to learn that day how to ride out of there.
On that bike. Just to stay upright and go straight. Don't turn. So, you'll be fine.
He actually unveiled that in an interview that he did, which I thought was very interesting. That he, you know, because a lot of these actors, they always, oh, can you do this? Oh, yeah, I can do it. They don't know how to do
it. Or they have a double that does it.
Well, I'm pretty sure
they didn't have a budget for that in this.
No, I'm pretty sure that he, the parts where he's riding back down, you know, to meet the rest of the people, that probably wasn't him. All the times you couldn't see his face on the bike, probably not him. But he couldn't fake that leaving. The spinning of the tire where it cuts to the close-up of the, that probably wasn't him. So he probably did it just enough to get that one shot and then laid the bike down, probably.
I mean, he's a good-looking guy, but he is not a good actor. At least not in this. Of course, I just don't think that, I don't think it was written very well. I didn't like this movie at all. So I don't like anything about it, really. Transitions were kind of cool. The lighting was very cool. Yep. And the music was good. There, I've said all nice things.
Well, the soundtrack, there's one band in all of these that was real. And they were called the Blasters. Blasters?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the Blasters.
Yeah, the ones or the stripper girl. Yeah.
Yeah.
They spent a lot of time on this singer, so yeah. That's got to be
Well, here's what happened with that group. He was invited, that group was invited to play some songs in 48 Hours. If you remember in 48 Hours, the boys are back in town, right? The boys are back in town. He was asked to play in that, and they turned it down. The movie was such a hit that when they were asked about this one, they thought they would be stupid not to do it. So that's why they did it. All right, so the other piece of trivia to know about this movie, probably the coolest scene in this movie was in when they met up in the bar with the roadmasters, the street gang, and he took the knife away from him, the butterfly knife away from him.
Try it again, punk.
That wasn't scripted. That was actually ad-lib. And the reason why it was ad-lib, Michael Parr, the main character, was actually a chef. Being as he was a chef, he used to like to play with knives, and he automatically knew how to do a butterfly knife. A butterfly knife is not a kitchen knife, so I don't know how they're related. But one of the actors that was in the movie had that knife and was playing with it. And so Michael took it from him because he knew how to do it too. And then they put that part together right there on the spot.
Cool.
So that was probably the coolest thing in the movie, I would say. The coolest scene. All right, Diane Lane was only 18 when they started filming. So she was 17 when they were cast, 18 when they started filming. She actually had her high school graduation card sent to her trailer while they were filming this. Many of the bikers that you see in the film as the bombers are actually HAs.
Really?
They evidently, the HAs like to be in films. The crew slightly modified their bikes, their leathers, haircuts, and beards so that they would fit the look of the film. No, they modified it a lot. There's no way that the HAs would look like that.
They must have been in the back.
Yeah.
The attackers were the real-life bandmates of Laurie Sargent, who provided the singing voice for Ellen Aim. Their band was called Face to Face, and they played mainly new wave music around the Boston area. But the group split up in 1988.
Oh.
So basically everybody from that band was in this movie except the main singer. Just her voice was.
Yep.
So it was like, yeah, you're not cute enough to be the lead, so.
Well, the film is named after a song by Bruce Springsteen. And they were trying to get negotiations, money talks, to include it in the film. But they kept getting delayed and delayed and delayed. So eventually they just didn't include it. They just left the name, though.
Okay, here's some stuff about Rick Moranis.
Rick Moranis. He's a moron.
Michael Parr had problems with Rick Moranis. This is a quote from Michael Parr. Rick Moranis drove me out of my mind. There's this whole wave of insult comedy. In the real world, if someone insults you a couple of times, you smack them or punch them. You can't do that on a movie set. And all these comedians walk around and they say whatever they want. I'm just not that handy with that. Comedians are a special breed. They can antagonize you and say whatever they want. And you can't do anything to stop them. He's this weird-looking little guy who couldn't get laid in a whorehouse with a fistful of 50s. He would imitate me. The first thing he says to me is, "Do you just act cool? Are you really cool?" That was the first sentence out of his mouth to me in Joel Silver's office. And I was like, oh, this is not going to go well. Walter Hill was reluctant to cast Diane Lane because he felt that she was too young for the role. He met Diane in New York City, and she auditioned for him in black leather pants, a black mesh top, and high-heeled boots. He was surprised with her, quote, total commitment to selling herself as a rock and roll star. Yeah, that's why she got the part.
She wanted it because she thought she was going to be able to sing, because she's a singer. But they didn't let her sing. Yeah, I want to see the world for free. But I don't like the things you see. Up to three, four, really ain't my style.
The Torchy's bar dancer was Jennifer Beals' dance double in Flashdance.
Yep.
Her name is Maureen John.
Yeah, there was a lot of... when was Flashdance made? There was a lot of Flashdance-ish things and people in this.
Jim Steinman.
Meatloaf's main dude.
Jim Steinman later recalled as thinking the script was terrible, but he thought the film was going to be a big hit, in part because of the enthusiasm of Joel Silver. He said, "This movie is about visuals. It's about excitement. It's about thrills. Don't worry about the script. I remember mentioning it to six or seven people that the script was really trashy, and I always got the same answer. The script doesn't matter. The movie is about the visuals. And when we go to the first edit, the first cut of the movie in the screening room, and it's Jimmy Iovine and me and Joel Silver. And about 20 minutes into the movie, Jimmy turns to me and goes, 'This movie is really shitty, isn't it?'"
So that is going to be it for today's review and reaction and trivia. So if you guys watched this movie, what did you think? Do you think it qualifies as a biker film? The next one that we're going to do is CC and Company. I had somebody ask about it, and it was already on our list and started, actually. So it's going to be the next one. It's got Joe Namath in it.
Please don't suck.
And it's going to be the next one, which is a jump back into the 60s, 70s time period again. If you know of another one that jumps forward, because I don't want to stay 60s, let me know what you suggest we do after that one, and we'll do it. Now, we are going to go to Thunder by the Bay next week. So, I don't know when you're watching this. Next week, as when we're filming this. So, it will likely be the next biker movie segment episode will be after that rally. So, but as far as this one, if you see this before the rally, we are going to Sarasota, Florida, and we will be there from the 14th through the 18th, I believe. And we'll be eating at a place called Bricks Smoked Meats. We're eating there on Friday. If you want to join us there and say hi, that's perfectly fine. We will also be going, of course, to the rally. If you're in the area and you see us, please stop us. Say hello. We'd love to meet you. And yeah, hopefully it will be a good rally. We haven't been to this one either. So this is our first one going to Sarasota. We've been, obviously, to the ones in St. Pete. But this is our first one going to Sarasota. So it's also our first one this year. So we're anxious to get back on the road. Today was actually pretty good as far as the temperature goes. It was no longer freezing, but it was rainy.
And we're going to test out some new gear on that trip.
We are.
Yep. I have a new full-face helmet that I'm really anxious to try out. I was also given a trunk. that I can try out from Viking Bags. So that was given to Biker Barbie, given to me to try out. So I'm really excited to try that out as well. And we got some rain gear we hopefully won't have to try out, but
yep.
We
might. And then Viking Bags sent me a bag as well. So we have a couple of pieces of gear to review. Of course, we will review it as we use it. And we haven't had to use it yet, which is why I know they're waiting, going, where's my my episode, my review? Yeah. Haven't used it yet, so gotta wait.
Dude,
so.
It's February. Yeah. Calm down.
So, but we'll put that out there as well once the time comes. So,
Yeah, don't forget to like and subscribe if you're watching this video. I know a lot of you guys are watching and are enjoying the video. That's awesome. Hit the like button. And if you haven't already, please subscribe, because that little gesture goes a long way with our algorithm and really helps other people see this video too. And if you like it so much, you want other people to enjoy it, feel free to share it and tell them to subscribe. That would be awesome. That would be a Valentine's Day gift for us.
Something else that people don't think about with liking. If you like the video, then it tells YouTube you like motorcycle content.
Yeah, then you get more stuff in your feed.
So yeah, so not just us, but more people in motorcycle related stuff. So hit the like button. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's free. It's totes free. Click that button. Click that left subscribe.
All right, guys. And so we'll talk to you in the next one. So until then, stay free. Keep it shiny side up.